Hello, good morning. Hello, good morning.
Good morning, Alistair.
Hello, good morning, Alistair.
Great. We're about to commence.
Good morning, Alistair.
Good morning, Alistair. How are you?
I'm pretty good. Once again, let me say good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Again, my name is Alistair Glean. I'm the technical specialist in the International Trade and Regional Integration Program of the Directorate of Technical Cooperation for the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture. I'm stationed in the St. Lucia office of the Eastern Caribbean States. Let me issue a welcome to all participants, to my colleagues in headquarters, the wonderful ladies in this forum, our participants from across the Caribbean and North America, and also to our audience, our attendees listening via YouTube and Facebook. Welcome to this forum titled Rural Women and Gender Equity in the Face of COVID-19 Pandemic. This session is specially targeted for the Northern and Caribbean regions. And again, we all know that everyone has been affected by this pandemic. The health issues are real, they are devastating. And at the same time, we recognize that the economic and social fallout is also equally devastating. It's really tragic. And my prayer and my hope is that you and your families will be safe and cope with this current crisis. As a result of this crisis, the IICA Director General, Dr. Manuel Otero, has launched this initiative to determine the impact of COVID-19 on rural women and to identify the priority needs at this time. And hopefully we can obtain suggestions for the recovery process post-COVID and even at this current time. I don't want to spend much time speaking on this. Rather, I would rather pass on to the director of the Directorate of Technical Cooperation, Dr. Federico Villarreal, who will share with us a bit more on the background and this current initiative. So let me pass on to Dr. Villarreal.
Thank you, dear Alistair. Welcome, everyone. I'm really pleased and honored to be part of this forum. First, I want to thank Carmen Nurse, Tania Liu, Sue, William Goddard, Tamisha Lee, Jennifer Spencer, Sean Hoyes, Shauna Brandon, Alistair Glean, and Annie Marie William on behalf of the Institute. In most particularly, thank Ileana Ramirez, Priscilla Zuniga, Nadia Monge, Ina Harvey, Mariela Zuniga, Carlos, Alicia, and Silvia, younger people, Willie Chan, Brent Theofield, Rachel Pierce, Louis, Arnold de Mendoza, Karen Montiel, Gabriela Quiroga, Manuel Messina, and JC, Kurt DeLis, and Diego Montenegro for their commitment and professionalism in this work. As everyone knows, the COVID-19 pandemic has strong implications in rural areas. Rural women are the most affected by gender injustice, and this crisis is not an exception, since on the one hand, the source of income had disappeared or decreased dramatically, and on the other, their productive participations have been limited, which reduced their income and access to food. In turn, the division of labor and the limitation faced by women accentuated in this global context of pandemic. The increase of the responsibility that fall on them for the care of their sons and daughters, as well as the housework, increased their time dedication. In addition, they suffer serious repercussions in terms of an increased violence that many of them face throughout the region. Since the implementations of the middle term plans with establishment at the request of the member countries of the cascading areas on gender and youth, many initiatives have been developed aimed at amplifying the voice of rural women and with this their visibility. That's how a basic framework of rural women in agricultural and rural territories has been developed. Two editions of the book, Warriors, Rural Women Around the World, 28, Enlightened Voice, were published with articles by renowned global women reference and photographed by award-winning photojournalist Sebastian Salgado. In alliance with the magazine Vogue Brazil, a special edition of On Rural Women in Latin America and the Caribbean was published, along with the photographic exhibitions, The Soul of Rurality. Being both present with the support of Vogue Brazil and prestigious private companies, many times in several countries in America and Europe, including the COP25. IICA participate as co-chair of the Rural Women segment and collaborate in identify the challenges that must be addressed and they are strategic for G20. In addition, every October 15, we carry out activities to commemorate the International Day of Rural Women, and this has become a permanent space in which IICA involves all its member countries in the discussion and promotions of public policies and technical cooperation actions that address the specific of rural women. In line with this commitment that IICA has assumed and aware of the implication of the COVID-19 crisis, we celebrate today these regional forums called Rural Women and Equity in the Face of COVID-19 Pandemic. The general objectives of this forum is to open the space for dialogue at the hemispheric level, so that rural women can share the realities and challenges they face as producers, workers, merchants, fisherwomen, artisans, etc., as a result of the pandemic of COVID-19. Likewise, throughout these dialogues, we will listen to specialists in gender who will provide us with recommendations to improve the response provided to women, designing specific actions to modify the pressing situations they are experiencing, and the process of reorganization of economy in basis on principle of equity and equality, which guarantees rural women an equal participation in agriculture and its productive chains. IICA will gather all the inputs and formulate recommendations to adequately address the needs of rural women in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. We're interested in listening, proposing, and acting with you in order to successfully face this crisis and help build a fiery rural world. Thank you very much again. I want to hear you now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Villarreal. I want to quickly move on. Now, it's important for us to understand the situation facing women, as Dr. Villarreal would have outlined. It is of paramount importance to the Institute. Women bring forth life, not only in terms of child rearing, but realistically, women strengthen the household, they build enterprise, and they strengthen our communities. As such, to understand what the women are dealing with during these troubling times is really and truly the first step in properly getting a grasp on how we can rebuild and move forward. This is why this forum is so important and so special to the Institute. Allow me to explain the format for today's session. Firstly, we've already had an introduction by Dr. Villarreal. Then we're going to spend 50 minutes hearing from the women from across the Caribbean region. We're going to hear from them their perspectives on the COVID-19 pandemic and how it's going to affect them. And then we're going to spend 10 minutes hearing from one of our colleagues from North America. Following this presentation, we're going to go into a 10-minute session where we'll provide a synthesis of the dialogue that would have taken place, and Dr. Rivera would have spoken to us on that. And that's going to be done by two of our ECA colleagues. And finally, we're going to close off with some recommendations on how we're going to move forward to address this issue. And this intervention will be made by Henry Williams from the CARICOM Secretariat. Our time is very limited. We want to respect the time of these experts, these persons who are actually living the situation. So we are basically going to have these short 10-minute interventions. Let me just give a bit of housekeeping. I would like to ask each panelist to present for 10 minutes. After 8 minutes, I will indicate that you have 2 more minutes. And when you are close to 30 seconds to completing, I will indicate same as well, that you have 30 seconds to complete. So we're trying to keep it very tight, and we're trying to make it very pointed. I'm going to ask 3 questions, and these questions would entail the following. Basically, I'm going to ask the women, what difference has the pandemic made in their livelihood and their working conditions in the sector in which they are particularly involved? Secondly, I'm also going to ask them, what are the main needs of rural women in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic? So they're basically going to share with us their perspectives on these 2 issues. But I'd also like to throw something else into the mix. I would like to hear from the women as well, how they are facing this current pandemic. How are they addressing this current context? So I would hope that each participant can also include that in their presentation. So with that said, allow me to introduce our distinguished panel. And these are, as I said, real experts. They are actually living the situation. Let me start off first with Mrs. Carmen Nurse. Mrs. Carmen Nurse is currently the president of the Caribbean Network of Rural Women Producers, CANROP. She's also the president of the Miku Cluster of the St. Lucia Network of Rural Women Producers. She's a secondary school teacher at the Miku Secondary School. Miku is a community in the south of St. Lucia. She has been a teacher for over 26 years, almost 27 years in the profession. And she is originally a native of Guyana, and she is a graduate of the University of Guyana in the area of secondary education and teaching. Next, we move on to Mrs. Tania Lieuw-a-Soe. Tania Lieuw-a-Soe is the chairperson of the agricultural cooperative Wil-Umafu Sranan of Suriname. The organization was established in 2014 as a female agro cooperative and currently is comprised of 28 women from the districts of Bokopondo and Wanaka in Suriname. The organization is working in creating a unique strategy for the production of cassava porridge and other cassava-related products. And the organization has been working with communities on a limited scale to test cassava cultivation and processing as a potential source of income. Now, these women, they are very dynamic, and they are harvesting 12 metric tons per month of cassava. And from this quantity, 12,800 packages of cassava porridge per month are produced and distributed to over 300 supermarkets in Suriname. Let me move on to Ms. Gillian Goddard. Gillian Goddard is the co-director of ARCTT, which stands for the Alliance of Rural Communities of Trinidad and Tobago, and she's the co-owner of Sanitas Organics, a chocolate and farming company. She's responsible for a lot of the visioning of the organization, but all decision-making is taken from a collective perspective on the level of teams or groups. She does a lot of groundwork in the area of research and development. She develops recipes from scratch with minimal imported input and has also been developing toolkits for chocolate making, gardening, construction, using entirely locally made raw materials. Her life mission has been to support the amplification of indigenous knowledge. And she's also a joint organic farmer with another group on both a rural estate and an urban homestead. She provides training in chocolate making and other cocoa value-added production across the Caribbean. And I know personally she has been doing a lot of work in St. Lucia and reaching out to other Caribbean countries. Gillian has been leading in environmental and community activism for about 30 years. And most of her focus has been towards creating resilience in human and natural communities, equipping people to get intimate with their immediate environments and to find ways to recenter the local to their lives and institutions. I'll move on to Ms. Tamisha Lee. Tamisha is the president of the Jamaica Network of Rural Women Producers, an engineer by training. Tamisha is an activist in the area for both agriculture and for women's rights and gender equality. Tamisha has been all over the globe speaking on behalf of women in Jamaica and by extension the Caribbean. She's also the treasurer of the Caribbean Network of Rural Women Producers and is an active supporter of the rights of women and agribusiness development. Then I'd like to move on to Ms. Jennifer Spencer. Jennifer Spencer is from Guyana, and I'd like to say that Jennifer Spencer is the coordinator of the Women's Agro-processing Network. She has been in the position for 4 years. She has the responsibility to coordinate the day-to-day management of the office for 13 groups of rural women in the areas of marketing, distribution, finance, etc. The groups are spread far and wide in regions 1, 2, 4, 5, and 9 of Guyana, the Republic of Guyana. I think I will pause there for now, and I will introduce the additional participants from North America when that segment begins. So with that said, let me pass on to the panelists from the Caribbean, and we will start off with Mrs. Carmen Nurse. Mrs. Nurse, the floor is yours. Remember, we have 10 minutes.
Good morning to all. Thank you, Mr. Glenn, and for your warm introduction, and also to Dr. Villarin, if I got it right. Let me commend IICA for taking this opportunity to be the lead in initiating to host this program for women. Pregnancy is synonymous with women. The impact of COVID-19 on the livelihoods of women can be compared with pregnant women at varying stages of their final trimester who ended up losing their babies through no fault of their own. This dialogue brings to the table their experiences with the hope that help is on the way to cushion the recovery process. You cannot shut down a woman ready for birth. That is tantamount to murder. And the prolonged psychological impact it can have if intervention and support is not forthcoming. The unexpected, uncatered, unplanned, short notice shutdown of the OECS countries and Barbados forced farmers whose farms are located away from their homes to abandon their farms for self-preservation and adherence to national protocols. Social distances in agriculture does not correlate into fruitful outcomes. The farmers were caught with ready to harvest crops on the farms, eggs to sell, but no markets, animals to feed, but none to slaughter. Crops for St. Lucia Jazz Festival, but no jazz, and other similar events. The normal did not happen, and the pandemic resulted in instant loss of labor, products, markets, and financial investment. Enough to be discouraged, but we are thankful to be alive despite the many setbacks. As if the loss of crops, the increase in perennial larceny, no slaughtering of livestock, and limited agro-processing were not sufficient bad news, there came the loss of jobs to family members and closure of schools. Everyone at home ultimately resulted in the increase in utility costs, water, electricity, phone, internet, also food and cleaning agents. Just imagine the already multitasked mother and grandmother with little or no information on technology now has the additional responsibility to supervise his or her children in virtual classrooms. It does not stop there. The impact continues. I've seen and heard create advertisement and statements in Cornell, stay home and stay safe. Some women and children staying home 24/7 resulted in increased exposure, domestic violence, and abuse. Last but least, respiratory illness has been identified as one symptom of poor suffering with coronavirus disease. farmers during COVID-19 are losing crops due to lack of water, creating respiratory disease and death to crops. Although the regional drought is not related to COVID-19, the timing makes it up for serious consideration if we are to strengthen efforts to combat COVID-19. No water, no food. Sometimes as women, we say things based on painful and complex situation at hand. The labor pains become more intense closer to childbirth, and many mothers have said this is the last one. But there continue to be many last ones after the last one. COVID-19 will not have the final say. Greater blessings are still ahead of us. We still have the land. With countries opening up, the women are willing to continue to contribute to food and nutrition security of the family, community, country, and region. Because one usually rely from job, but not from their work. Our work is who we are. It is written that in every dark cloud, there is a silver lining. We are hoping that this forum will uncover the silver lining. It was Shakespeare put it this way, sweet are the benefits of adversity. This pandemic paid the most modern scene for the need to promote agriculture. With all boats still closed, the local farmers and manufacturers are now the primary food suppliers in each country. This should be our normal. The pandemic can be the incubator that forcefully drives new government policies and programs for creating opportunities and passion to achieve the vision of self-sufficiency in food production. Deliberate support and promotion of agriculture entrepreneurship will eliminate the fight for the same piece of the pie, but instead create a bigger pie. Here are some of our suggestions for short to medium and long-term recovery from COVID-19 for women in agriculture. Short to medium-term recovery, we are saying that there is need for an economic stimulus relief package for some farmers, because there are some vendors and farmers who are totally dependent on agriculture for economic survival. Deliberate access to markets, especially for processed items, and the prune standards. Deliberate promotion of farming. We cannot all farming needs, but if we can promote farming at every home and ensure nutritional security. Women representation in the planning and decision making initiative of COVID-19 as was taking place now, the way forward. Program mitigate domestic violence and abuse. There are so many women who are single women or those in homes where even though they are contributing financially to the home, are being abused verbally, physically, and emotionally, and they are free to speak out. But there are organizations in this group that assist. And we are hoping that belong to our culture group once identify that the necessary steps be taken to reach out to such individuals. We have, with COVID-19, the need for water dispensers. The purpose is to wash hands at the vent place and also to receive water so that we can adhere to the protocols. There are many who sell the community, but in the sun, so we are recommending the need to supply of folding umbrellas for protection, storage facility for crops. If we had enough storage facility, our crop loss would have been minimized. Revolving fund. We know that money answered all things. And so there is need for money to buy subsidies. There is need for grants. There is need to, for assistance. Land preparation. We are asking that you, if we can get assistance with the plowing, we will do the planting. Distribution of seeds, fertilizers, so as to promote and encourage the continuation. Access to packaging materials, and we know most of them are imported, so as to continue the packaging for the agro-processors. Creation of further promotion of farmers market. We have mentioned this, we are and technical assistance in agro-processing to make crops market ready. Establishment of a seed bank, and capacity building production and processing entrepreneurship. There are some. And the long term, the use of productive of protective agriculture technology. We are looking at greenhouses here. Development of active agro-processing facility here. Maybe we can come in and do agro-processing at that particular location. And protesting for traditional value and shelf life of ducks so as to get them ready to the market. I thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Nurse. You stuck within the time, and that is really fantastic. And I think you addressed some key issues affecting the women, particularly that analogy with pregnant women and losing a child. And I think only, as one of my colleagues told me across the region, only a woman who has been pregnant can really understand what you're sharing. So I thank you for that intervention. We move quickly on to Mrs. Tania Lieuw-a-Soe, and I hope I got the pronunciation correct. Tania, can you deliver your presentation? Please be mindful of the time restriction. Thank you. Tania, are you able to hear us, Tania? Tania? It seems Tania may be having some technical difficulty. So while Tania is preparing, maybe we can move on to our next presenter, which is Gillian Goddard from Trinidad and Tobago. Gillian, can you proceed?
It's great to see some familiar faces and also to meet some of you all for the first time. I will probably be harassing you all in the weeks ahead to try and collaborate on certain things. So thank you, IICA, for organizing this. I'm going to put my timer on to make sure that I stay on top of it. So rural women in Trinidad and Tobago is not a homogeneous group. So there are different needs for different ages, for different subregions, for the different cultures we have here. But there obviously are some general strengths and challenges, which are accentuated by the COVID-19 situation. The first few weeks when COVID started to enter the region, many of the rural women in our network were very disoriented. And I was one of those who was very disoriented. For a few years, we had actually been moving in the direction of a lot of success in the chocolate sector. And in a way, many of us in agriculture felt like it was the first time we really were, especially as women, getting a handle on participating in the money coming into agriculture. And instead of just doing primary production, we were involved in agro-processing. And all of a sudden, chocolate production and chocolate tourism came to a complete standstill. The cocoa sector and the chocolate sector had been reviving throughout the country in all the rural areas. And all of a sudden, all of us had to close production. For other processors, for people who produce goods for wholesalers and for restaurants and markets, there was no longer any movement, no warning, no gradual rollback. And in general, women were very scared and anxious. I want to read a testament from one of our cocoa farmers, a female cocoa farmer, and she also processes. She said, COVID-19 is a shocking revelation to me. I became aware that I should plant more food. I became resourceful, germinating seedlings from my kitchen greens. The dormant effects of COVID-19 on the cocoa sector has really had a negative impact on cocoa farmers, including myself. I am at a stumbling block. I continue to do value-added products and hope eventually that the effects of COVID-19 remain a part of us, where we continue to plant to feed ourselves. And what she said here has actually been the experience that I would say a lot of us are having. Nevertheless, there are some advantages that rural women have under COVID. Generally, the global data bears out that it's slower for us to get viral exposure in our area. So when COVID started entering Trinidad and Tobago, the people living in more remote areas started locking down very quickly. Under COVID, rural women have access to certain kinds of food. So in the communities, what you see is that people are sharing their provisions. The end of the dry season is a tough time. It's a time when there's not a lot of stuff bearing. Mango season hasn't started, but it still is possible. And what you're seeing is that food at that level is available. In the rural areas, many of the rural areas in Trinidad, people are more accustomed to stay-at-home lifestyle and crises because they're accustomed to landslides, the roads not being passable, weather problems. So in a way, there are interventions in place and support mechanisms within the community that were able to be mobilized fairly quickly. One of the other things is that within rural areas, people continued to move around. So within their community of 200 people, 300 people, 400 people, there still was movement, and it's not showing as though it actually worsened the situation. One of the other things, advantages, is that people are not as dependent on money economies as urban women. So even before we entered COVID, there was an understanding of getting resources without it having to be from cash. And the other thing is that in rural areas, it's not a good thing, but it is something that made people bounce back quickly. They're not accustomed to attention from national governments and institutions. So they know in rural areas, you know that you have to actually solve your problems. But there are many disadvantages, and many of these disadvantages didn't start with COVID. For one, in Trinidad and Tobago, in Trinidad in particular, but Tobago also, there's a major problem with land ownership. And what you saw during COVID lockdown is that immediately a lot of the men in the community started ramping up their gardens. They expanded their farming plots. But because the ownership of women is very low in Trinidad, it was not possible for a lot of women to do this. And what we saw were, especially with younger women, moving, trying to figure out where they could actually plant. So that is definitely an issue that has to be addressed. As was said by Ms. Nurse, and basically we know that the childcare and domestic responsibilities are almost 100% in our domain as women. So rather than women being less busy, many women were more busy and had to multitask at ridiculous levels. And Alistair, you did say that you wanted to hear a little bit from us personally, and I would have to say that is definitely the case on my side. I don't think I have cooked so many continuous meals for must be 20 years. It seems like it never stops. Communication and ICT challenges are really problematic in rural areas. People have phones that are functioning at a fairly low level, and we are accustomed to face-to-face interaction. So when that face-to-face interaction went down, the lack of devices became very obvious and really showed up how the problems are in terms of trying to communicate with each other outside of the community and even within the community. It was very hard to find out about the incentives that the government was putting out. So what we ended up doing in our network, we had to keep passing it from people who had more access, and then using as many smartphones and trying to get information about how you could get support, what the forms are like, where they come from. So it's definitely a flaw that showed up. One of the worst things was that the food supply chains were badly interrupted. In many rural areas in Trinidad, both women and men rely on the wholesalers with their vehicles coming through because people don't have vehicles and women have fewer vehicles than men. And so with the wholesalers not coming to rural areas, the products could not go out. And so one of the advantages is that in the smaller villages, they were accustomed to doing a more polyculture approach. So they would have more provisions and perennial crops in the smaller communities. So for them, it was not as much of a challenge, but it obviously still was a challenge. And for families who did the larger plots, women definitely had many problems getting their products to markets. Because in Trinidad and Tobago, our fruit stalls were able to stay open. The markets, the farmers' markets stayed open. The market stayed open with restrictions, but they stayed open. It wasn't that there weren't places to send the stuff to necessarily, but there was no movement of the goods. The supply chains got heavily interrupted. On the other side, many rural shops closed. The shopkeepers are older and women are responsible for buying the products. And many of the shopkeepers just closed their shops. They said they couldn't risk going out there and catching COVID. Cash flow issues, as Carmen said, those were worsened. And the challenge is we went into COVID with a problem. There's a national reforestation program which hires people in 20 communities in Trinidad, and that had been dismantled in the end of February, beginning of March. And it was supposed to start back. They were supposed to rehire new teams, and that got interrupted by COVID. So in several of the communities that I interact, almost a quarter of their adult force workforce went into COVID with no money. Through this project, this is where they made most of their money. But what are some good things that have come out of it? Definitely females, including young females, are planting. We have been trying to push that in our network for years, and we were not having a lot of success, but that has definitely happened. Another thing that is good is that the vulnerabilities are more evident, so you know where to problem solve. We saw some of the challenges before, but they're clearer now, including off-farm inputs like fertilizer and pesticides are not dependable. The markets are not dependable.
More minutes.
Yeah, yes. And the perennial polyculture, planting provisions, trees and so on, is definitely more resilient than annual crops. And you're seeing young women even getting involved in this now. So what are some of the recommendations? The recommendations that IICA has in their paper that they put together from the survey are excellent. The one thing we want to re-emphasize is community cohesion is critical and collectives need to be formed. So thank you for your time and I look forward to hearing from the other participants.
Thank you very much, Gillian. Those were some very insightful inputs and comments. It's interesting that besides what we heard from Carmen in terms of the challenges accessing markets and lack of revenue and income, that you spoke to the inability to connect physically, and as such, it showed up the absence of technology and the inability to get information to the rural women, information, government initiatives, etc., and the disruption of food supply chains where marketers are unable to reach you all with goods and goods going out. And that's pretty interesting to hear. But I'm glad to hear that there were some advantages you highlighted in terms of women having access to food, in terms of from the rural community, and not as dependent on a cash-related system. So that's interesting for us to note. So I'm glad we're also hearing on how you're addressing the situation in the face of the COVID-19. We had some comments from Belize. I just want to quickly share that colleagues from Hot Mamas in Belize would have indicated that, again, they would have experienced some disruption, absence of markets and loss of revenue, but they indicated that they have been using the opportunity to attend webinars, to retool, to organize their offices, to clean and maintain their equipment, getting ready for a restart post-COVID. And they are keeping in touch with their staff to ensure that they're staying safe and healthy. So colleagues are making efforts to address the pandemic and to stay on top of things. So let's move on quickly though. Let's see if we can get Tania back on. Tania, are you available at this point?
Yes, I'm available, Alistair. And my apologies, because I think that my internet connection is suffering from COVID as well. So I do not guarantee that you will hear me constantly. So let me start quick with whatever I think that we can give from our site. And if I lose connection, I hope that at least the main points are taken. It's very difficult to speak after well-spoken women who actually raised all the problems. And I definitely think that the problems are in the Caribbean or in the world, everywhere, more or less the same if it comes to rural. It will be too much to tell you and to tell the world or to remind the world of the fact that we should really acknowledge the fact that rural women are the biggest providers of food and food security in the world. So we definitely need to address the problems they are facing collectively. Alistair, as you all know me, or some of you know me, I'm working in the field, I'm working with women, so that's why I chose to speak from the heart and to really share with you all what we are facing. We as a women group in Suriname has created a strategy where we participated in a lot of technical cooperations, a lot of webinars or trainings to enrich our knowledge. And as far as we could reach remote rural women, the remote areas, most of them has participated to try to enrich their knowledge. So we are speaking about at least in the last 2 years, at least 400 women. And it is fair.
It seems Tanya's having some connectivity issues. Let's hope that she can come back on. In the event that she's unable to rejoin immediately, we would come back to her, but maybe we can move on to Tamisha Lee from Jamaica. So Tanya, if you're able to hear us, we will come back to you once you resolve the connectivity issues, but we'll hear from Tamisha at this point. Tamisha, are you available?
Yes, I am, Alistair.
Can you proceed?
Good morning, colleagues. Sure. Good morning, colleagues, all, and to all those who are listening through the different social media outlets, all protocols duly acknowledged. First, I would like to thank IICA for the opportunity to participate as a panelist in today's forum. Very timely, relevant, and important. I will briefly share with you the impact of COVID for women maker, looking at challenges, needs, and opportunities under the theme, A Chance to Reset the Button for Rural Women. Prior to COVID-19, a lot of rural women farmers had lost their crops during the drought. So they headed into a COVID-19 crisis, already facing setbacks. Several female farmers faced surplus and spoilage due to the reduced opening hours of the corner shops who purchased from them. For example, many of our rural women who are involved in poultry, the jerk man to sell their chicken. So you will find that they have a surplus of the impact. The closure of the limitation gathering their produce.
Can I ask you to hold 1 second, Tamisha? Let me refer to my colleagues in headquarters. Is it possible that the videos can be affecting the overall connectivity? Maybe it may be wise first to take off the videos for a bit and see if it will improve the connection.
It should.
Can we stop our videos for a bit and see if it'll improve our connection?
Hi, Alistair. Hi, everyone. Yes, it's possible that, well, I've seen, I see everyone turn the camera off, and that may help. So we can continue.
So, Tamisha, can you proceed?
Oh, sure. Thanks. The livelihood of many rural women are fragile on the basis that they purchase food almost on a daily basis according to their availability to earn. COVID-19 has brought double burden for rural women. They must struggle to maintain their livelihood amidst the dislocation caused by the pandemic. The closure of school has also increased their responsibility as caregivers and homeschoolers. Several women have already informed me of having difficulties to feed their families. And I can share with you just one of the many texts that comes to me on a daily basis of the challenges that our rural women are facing. And I quote, "Hey, Miss Lee, my name is, I am having some issue right now regarding food and shelter. I have 3 kids and things are not the way it should. And because of the pandemic, I am having it very rough." What are some of the needs of our women? The woman needs input such as seeds and fertilizer to get them back into production as quickly as possible and help to identify a reliable market for their products. We will still need to eat as a nation, and rural women should contribute to domestic food security. The women need food supply so they can feed their children. And the Jamaica Network of Rural Women Producers has already started to assist our women to apply for the government care grant. And we are considering to use our own funds to provide immediate assistance. In a global crisis, it is important to get the facts out there. Facts is important. And with social media, there's a lot of misinformation going around. We are equipping our members with relevant and factual information on COVID-19, example from WHO, PAHO, to counter some of the misleading information circulating on social media. It is important for rural women to get correct information on the coronavirus and the government regulation that have been put in place so the women do not violate the established protocol. We have also inform them of helpline in relation to gender-based violence. Statistics have shown that in a global crisis, our women are more prone to gender-based violence. And even internationally, violence against women have increased due to the stay-at-home orders. As such, we have provided them with information, and luckily, we have not had any reports from any of our members experiencing gender-based violence. This is a perfect opportunity to ensure that our rural women have equal access to the resources and opportunities they need to be more productive. This pandemic has demonstrated the importance of essential services, of which the production of food is central. We are therefore presented with the chance to reset the button on how we treat agriculture and importantly, rural women producers. In closing, I want to take the opportunity to tell women around the world, we know these are trying times, but others have prepared us for such a time as this. We may bend, but we won't break. When the dust settles, we will emerge much stronger as true champions with a renewed strength and renewed energy to continue in the fight towards eradicating hunger, ending poverty, ensuring our nation's food security and nutrition. Thank you very much for giving me a listening ears. Please be safe and well. God bless.
Thank you very much, Tamisha, and you will well within the time frame. It's interesting that you would have highlighted the importance of us supporting each other, and it's clear that you are working with the women in Jamaica. And I want to commend the Institute, the IICA, the Director General, Dr. Otero and Dr. Villarreal for this forum, because it allows us to come together and address the issues. And I think that it's not just a talk shop. We have technicians here, we have other specialists on board who are able to work with women coming out of this situation to seek solutions and to seek a mechanism for them to restart and rebuild what was lost. And I'm glad that Tamisha would have spoken about the resilience of the Caribbean people, of the resilience of the Caribbean women, the rural women. They're not gonna break, they may bend, but they're gonna move forward stronger. And it's important for us to note the need to address the misleading information that's out there. And we take that, Tamisha, and the importance of resetting the button. We had a colleague out of St. Vincent and the Grenadines who last week shared with us. She indicated that during this pandemic, we have the opportunity to refocus, to look at planning, proper planning, focus on production planning, strategic planning for businesses, et cetera. And I think that goes well with what Tamisha would have shared. So let me thank you again, Tamisha. We want to move on, go back again to Tania. I hope Tania is able to connect with us again. Tania, are you able to connect again? Okay, it seems Tania is still having some difficulty. So let's go straight on to our colleague from Guyana. That is Ms. Jennifer Spencer. Jennifer, are you able to hear us?
Yes, I'm hearing you.
Please proceed, Ms. Spencer. Remember, we have 10 minutes, and we also want to hear you speak on how it is the women of Guyana are addressing the current pandemic in this particular context. Thank you.
Okay. Good morning again to everyone. I must say all protocol observed, and gratitude to IICA for allowing this platform. One of our main focus here will be production issues and also transportation and marketing. Those are our main focus this morning. In looking at our production, the inputs, we have realized that our inputs, they're lower now, they're lower volumes due to the social distancing and the curfews. Also, because of that, the prices have increased for our inputs. Prices have increased. Transportation costs to purchase these things have also been an issue or to deliver them. For our volumes of workers, our workers here in Guyana, they work in a space that is conducive for them to be able to work even in this situation because of how the factories are set up. So I will say, even although this COVID situation is pressing and it's hard for us, we still have some scope. But one of the main issues that will prevent our ladies from actually moving towards our factories or operating in the factories is because the markets are closed. So it's difficult to produce when there's no market. Concerning our transportation costs for our products, as I said, the marketplace or to the marketplace, it has become difficult. We recognize now that the cost to get our things there or the trips to get our products out to the market, it has become more expensive. It's more expensive. It's also less frequent for us to be able to do that because the service providers have to generate a little more income to support their families. So like that, of the goods moving to the market, it has become expensive. When we have to market our finished products, that also seemed to be an issue. As I explained before, the markets are fewer. There are fewer marketplaces are available. A lot of our main market areas are the places that we usually deliver our goods. They're now taking less products because the days of opening and so on, there are fewer days that these places are being opened. And a lot of our products here from the women, our rural women, a lot of them, they're not deemed as essential products. And presently, the COVID-19 situation has caused us to to concentrate mainly on essential products and items. As we go on concerning our market situation, we recognize also that there's a decrease in the demand in our capacity to be able to buy things. So because there's a decrease in demand due to a decrease in spending power of our consumers, whose jobs, some of them may have lost their jobs, or it might have decreased because of the number of hours that they're working, it puts a damper on the actual movement of the product to these marketplaces. When we look at also the in terms of our finished products getting out there, one positive aspect of this COVID-19 is the availability of our social media markets. It's available. That's a plus in terms of the COVID-19 because more persons are using it. But yet, at the same time, for the rural women, it's difficult for them because a lot of them they live in the areas where the network they're unable to access the the internet, they're unable to be able to get clean or clear connections sometimes. Sometimes even although this is it's a plus for us in terms of our products being out there, marketing it through the social media and so on, it's not easy for the women in the rural areas at this point. And some of the general challenges for agro-processors in Guyana and producers, the markets are open for shorter periods, that's one. In some cases, on few days during a given week some of our fresh produce vendors, they have taken their products to consumers, either via stationary roadside vending, or they use mobile units, or they drive through villages. These methods, although useful for our consumers, they are not really supported by our public health ministry in Guyana. So this poses a problem also for the women in this part of the region. One other key thing, some of our women as entrepreneurs, they have funds in the bank, or they have funds that they can access. But because of the banking systems that have shorter periods and the ATM lines are extremely long, it becomes difficult for them to be able to access their funding. So one other key thing, insufficient opportunities also to them for accessing of loans. The opportunities are not there. It's not there for them. They're unable to access loans at this time. It's a crisis for them. Also for them, they have insufficient access for assistance to their households in situations where the income generation of our agro-processors are diminishing. We know most of our women, the rural women, they are the sole breadwinners of their homes. So when their income generation has lowered, it becomes a problem in the home and things become steep. And we all know children are at home and all of that. It's real difficult at this time. Also, some of the things that they have to look at for these women in rural areas, everything that they have to do at this time, meaning they have to take care of children, they have to take care of their husbands, they still have to go on farms, or some of them have to go to the factories, and it's kind of difficult because you need to go out there, number one. In this season where we have to go out there secure. Most times we're on the streets, we have to wear masks, we have to do, so all these things have to be accessible to them. And we know with the disposable masks, you're supposed to be disposing daily after every use and not even an entire day. So finances become a great challenge in these areas. Also, in some of the areas, or like in region one, one of our producers said the cassava suppliers are complaining about their produce being left on their hands. And this is due to a decrease in the production at the factories as it is. One also said that most of their products, that is also the region one, network factory that's in the Blue Flame, their great one of their great demise was that most of their products are sold in Georgetown. Most of their products are distributed in Georgetown. And because of that, being a main distribution center in Georgetown and also where the Women's Agro-processors Development Network is also the place where the goods are stored, and it's presently closed. So that's a great challenge for them. This has created a huge challenge for the women whose livelihood depends on the daily operation in the factory. Presently, now the factories are closed.
Jennifer, can I just tell you, have 2 more minutes, and we'd like to request that you turn on your video for the remainder of your presentation so that our colleagues on Facebook and YouTube can see you. Thank you.
Yes. Okay, sorry, Renan. Yes, also in one of the other areas in the Pomeroon region, one of our producers being our main extra virgin coconut oil producer, she indicated that her sales were dropped down to 20%. And this is due to the transportation via boat that was down. The service was absolutely down. She could not have access. So her fresh stock, which is the fresh coconuts, had to be sold instead of adding value to that. Therefore, it means that her income, it was lowered, or the income generation was tampered with. We also looked at some of our other groups that are in the Region 5 area, the Mykonei farmers. During the season, they have been challenged with predator larceny because a lot of the villagers, they're out of jobs. Some of them, they're just going for a few days and a few hours. So that's a big challenge for them also. Some of them in the Barbies area, the Small Women Association also finds this difficult at this time. One of the things I will suggest at this time also, in terms of addressing the need or addressing what I think they may need, somebody mentioned about revolving fund, but I want to say to you that the Women's Agro-processors Development Network, we have a revolving fund that is there, and it's just a mega 1% that is usually charged. But what I will say at this time, I think we will need an additional revolving fund, because presently a continuous thing or something to merge with that, because presently there are a lot of the rural women who have tapped into it, but loans are still to be paid, and this pandemic has been going on for like about 2 months now, and we don't know how long it will go on. So my suggestion is that we kind of look into having a huger or a larger revolving fund so that we can help to offset most or some of their expenses at this time. So those are some of my main concerns. Thank you for listening. I hope I've contributed something that you can make sense out of. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Spencer. Indeed, you have. Those were fantastic inputs, and we are quite pleased with the contributions that we're hearing so far. I want to just make a slight adjustment. What we'd like to do is have the persons that are speaking turn on their videos, and the rest of us will maintain the lack of video when we are not speaking. Let me try to get back my colleague, Tania from Suriname. Tania, are you able to speak at this point? It seems Tania is still having some difficulty accessing the microphone. So let's move on. And I want to express my gratitude for the contributions from the ladies of the Caribbean. Hopefully we'll have a quick wrap up before we close off. But I want to move on to our colleague from North America. In particular, we're talking about Canada. I want to introduce Ms. Shauna Hayes. Shauna Hayes is a senior gender equality specialist at Global Affairs Canada, providing technical advice to Canada's development programs in Asia and the Caribbean region. She has served as a long-term gender equality advisor with the Commonwealth Secretariat in the Maldives on the development of their five-year plan of action for women, and in-country gender equality advisor to the Ministry of Agriculture in Ethiopia. She has 3 years of work experience in education in Nigeria with a Canadian NGO, CUSO, and she has worked on gender equality and women's empowerment, sensitization, and project design with development partners, which include the African Development Bank, the World Bank, CDB, the Caribbean Development Bank, the Asian Development Bank, the International Monetary Fund, the international development NGOs, private sector companies, and governments. Sean brings a wealth of experience to this forum, and I'm confident that we will be able to embrace a number of the inputs that she will make. At this point, let me pass on to Sean. Sean, I invite you to participate and make your contribution. Kindly remember, we have 10 minutes to receive your presentation.
Thank you very much. I'd like to share my screen. I have just a quick little presentation. So let me see if this works. Is it working? Is it working? Okay.
Yes,
I'm seeing something. It's on screen.
Perfect. Okay, great. So just one clarification. I don't actually work in the Caribbean program anymore. So that's been a couple of years. I haven't been working, though that was anyway, but I focus mostly on Asia right now. So today, thank you so much. I really appreciate hearing from all the women on their difficulties and challenges, and also on some of their good recommendations of how to move forward. It's a very difficult time. I'm going to focus on our Canada's Feminist International Assistance Policy. So just to see if any of this could be part of any recommendation of how to move forward. So just going to go over a couple of things. So the Feminist International Assistance Policy objectives focus on three areas. So decision making. So how can women become equal decision makers with men at all levels? That's one thing. And then rights. So promoting and protecting the rights of women and girls in particular, and then having equal access and control to the resources and benefits. Now, I know that you have already raised a lot of these areas. So the feminist approach has four areas. So human rights-based and, human rights-based and inclusive for gender equality. So who are we looking at? Who are we identifying as the most vulnerable and marginalized? And how can we, really look at their difficulties and how can we address them? Strategic and focused. So strategic and focused decisions for the best possibility of addressing gender equality. So the partners we work with, the advocates we work with, and also who's really, what type of decision-making structures are in place so that gender equality is going to be at the center of it. Also transformative and activist for gender equality, for advancing gender equality and for the empowerment of women and girls. So transformative, what does that mean long-term? So long-term change that will really lead to empowerment of women and girls. And then activist, Well, the main thing for activists is to make sure that women have a voice and that the advocates that we involve are based on women's rights organizations and women's organizations that are really raising the issues and making those recommendations that need to change, you know, to make things change better for women. Evidence-based and accountable for gender equality means that we have to look at the results and we have to look at the evidence. And these four areas are the essential areas to apply to all programming. And especially in a crisis, we tend to drop, oh, well, that's separate, that's different, you know, we don't have time for that. Well, we do, we have to do it, you know, especially now in any crisis, we have to do it. Okay, what's wrong with this? So I don't know why this is not working. Okay, so I know that you have, the previous speakers have done a great job to identify some of the difficulties around the coronavirus, especially for rural women. And even our own Minister for Foreign Affairs has raised concerns over violations of fundamental rights and freedoms during lockdowns. So police being overly restrictive and anyway. There's also been a lot of questions around the testing, is it accurate? And I just put a link in here if you can have, you can check what the Tanzania president has done to see, are these tests accurate to begin with? So that's just a question. There's also predictions that more people will die from lockdown measures than from the virus. As you're talking about, women are already having difficulty to feed their family. And so people could die from just starvation and just malnutrition. Women are more affected, of course, from anything like this, being, you know, most responsible for food. So also, you also mentioned the different, the impact around rights, decision-making, access control, especially land access, seeds, water. All of these things have to look at how do we do it in terms of making sure that the most marginalized and vulnerable rural women and producers and farmers are also getting that equal access. It's very important. Okay. So transformative and activist. So how can communities change those unequal power relations? How can we use this opportunity, this reset button, so that we can work on changing harmful norms and practices that especially are negatively affect rural women and girls? And also to do that, we have to focus on changing harmful attitudes. So in setting up a revolving fund or any of the recommendations, there can be an element of changing attitudes towards making things better and more equal for women and girls, equal to what men. Even just the idea of farmers in some places, when people say farmer, they just think of men. They don't even think of women. So how can we engage men and boys in support of gender equality and the empowerment of women and girls in our work as well? So again, someone has to be accountable, and we have to take accountability for gender equality results. So making sure that we allocate the adequate funds and resources that are specifically focused on the needs of rural women and women farmers in agriculture, and establish accountability for that. Strategies to support women farmers. So I think I skipped a slide because I had something on gender-based violence somewhere. Here it is. Okay, impact of, so this is just a quick summary of a lot of the issues that are all intersecting and affecting everybody. not only, I mean, in Canada here and in many, many other countries. So, you know, domestic violence and against women and girls, and no services to respond to them. So no safe place for women and girls that are subject to violence in the home, and, you know, a lot of stress around that. You mentioned lack of access to basic needs and services, that was mentioned, loss of livelihoods, loss of income, restricted mobility and networking. So that's also the communication thing that you mentioned as well. Increased care burden and increased stress around that. Food insecurity in rural areas, it just seems, you know, but it's happening. It's happening everywhere in the world. And along with that, maybe people have enough food, but they don't have enough variety of food. They're not having fresh food. So nutrition is a problem. And the reduced markets you talked about, disrupted inputs, value chain and supply chains, isolation, lack of social interaction and depression. So all of these things are the real issues that will have a more negative impact on women and girls than you know, as usual, women are more affected. So this is...
Hi, Sean, you have 2 more minutes. And what I'd like to ask you, if you can briefly turn on your video so that our audience can see you, please.
I don't have a video link. My video's broken.
Okay, we have two more minutes.
Okay, so this is just my last slide, summarizing a few of the things that we could do that have been suggested in other contexts. So focusing on establishing the rights of women and women farmers, you know, that all of our initiatives, mainstream initiatives, start to focus on the rights of women, rural women, especially, and women farmers. And promote programs on how to we value women as farmers, equal valuing with men as farmers, and prevent the negative gender stereotypes. Increase rural women and women farmer in decision making at all levels. Try to engage with women's rights organizations in collaboration with men to end the harmful gender norms and social practices that still go on in many places, forced marriage, violence against women and girls. And I think another thing that could be an opportunity during this time of lockdown is to encourage men as fathers and caregivers in taking equal responsibility for household and care work. Why should women be doing all the work? It's a time for change. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sean. That presentation was very insightful. We thank you for that. It's important for us to note the value of changing attitudes, as you would have said, to encourage increased gender equality. And you spoke about the need to allocate more funds for the programs that these women would be involved in. It takes us back to what our colleague Ms. Spencer would have said out of Guyana, in terms of the need to enhance or rather increase the funding available to women. And as part of the whole issue of changing attitudes, we recognize that it's much more difficult for women. And I'm glad that you highlighted the opportunity to encourage men to be more involved in caregiving and managing the household. Because as we go back to our colleague from Guyana, women are facing serious challenges, increased prayer larceny, challenges even accessing the social media markets, which one of our presenters, Ms. Goddard, would have spoken to the opportunities through the social media market, but the women are facing challenges even doing those, or at least accessing those mechanisms. So they need to change attitudes, and for us to have increased gender equality is so critical at this point. So we thank you for that presentation. Let's try to get our colleague Tania back on. I believe she's on her phone now. Long awaited. Tania, the floor is yours.
Hi, Esther. As you know me, I do not think that this thing will win from me, so it doesn't matter how. I hope you all are hearing me.
Yes,
you hear me?
Yes, you're hearing me loud and clear.
Okay, so you know, as you know me, women always win. So I haven't heard much of the presentations, but before you all are losing me again, I just want to drop some things. I did hear some of the presentation of the lady from Canada. Forgive me if I don't know the name anymore. But here is the thing. I think that many of us knows about all these heartaches and difficulties of rural women. They were all there all the time. The only difference is that we all took our time to solve these problems and discuss a lot and whatever, create kind of programs, etc. But this COVID pandemic made us realize that there's no time to lose anymore. We are done talking. We need to come together and put some tangible results there to do things. We need to include these rural women in value chains and try to have them earn their own money. And I know that when the minute they start earning their own money, because they are included in some kind of value chains, which can actually serve the world, if they can earn their own money, they will solve a lot of other problems. So I'm putting it straightforward, and it might not be a polite way, but it's the reality. I think that IICA is there. IICA has a lot of staff in many countries on the ground. Let's sit together with all of us. We have these nice programs, and we know what's happening with rural women, and we know what we should do, etc. But we need to do it now. We need to include them. People are literally dying, malnutrition, etc. And we do recognize the fact that these women are actually taking care of the food security in the world. The minute that we will lose that component in the world, we will have a serious problem in terms of food security. So, you know, let's come together and really put tangible kind of results where we can really see that something is going on, that we can really help them. Let me give an example of what we are facing, and I did put it in my video as well. As 3 months ago, we had a very nice, bright future ahead of us, because with the grace of the Almighty, next week we will be opening our sophisticated processing facility. But while we are in the process to open this nice facility, we suddenly realize that we have no income, because we cannot get raw material to town because of the lockdown of COVID-19. Markets are closed. The export is hard to maintain now. So the nice vision, the nice dream, the nice work we actually were looking forward to has suddenly shaken us, and we woke up in a very bad dream. But if we do believe in a mighty God, we should also know that there's a message in this, because many of us were very disrespectful to nature. Those are the aspects that we need to take into consideration. We need to respect our nature much more and see what it's giving and offering us to make sure that we can maintain life on Earth. I think it is much harder for we know that we are blessed. It's much harder for women in the more remote areas, because they are not in the same process as us, although we are including them, because the people who knows about what we UMA, the women of Suriname, are doing, our organization is doing, is literally an inclusion of women in the more remote areas in our value chain, in the process of processing our food. And let me just drop a simple solution. If we look at the Caribbean, we all are constantly complaining about the fact that we have a way too high import bill, etc. Where is the point that we will demand now that women can, for example, or not only women, farmers can grow cassava and let governments come together and say that at least 10% cassava or local raw material should be included in flour for bread making, etc. Do we really understand this inclusion, what it will mean in terms of earning money by these rural people? So my final contribution is, because I think that all other has been said already in a better perspective than I can do, but the only point that I will actually put on the table and in closing my speech is, all that talk will not help us. And yes, we should be speaking and talking among each other, but to be frank, honest, I am not looking at any other forum to participate anymore, unless it's a forum that will really give me some tangible results and some tangible opportunities to help the women who are literally dying far in the interior. So I might have done this speech a bit passionate because it's really near to my heart. These are really things that we are literally facing every day. Every morning I'm awakened and asking myself, I am blessed, but how will I help my fellow sister who won't be able to put food on the table today and who really, really did her best to survive all those years? So my lovely colleagues and IICA and all donor agencies who might be listening to this, please, we need to come together and put some practical solution on the table, not all the technical cooperations, et cetera, et cetera, because it will not help solving the problem we are facing now. COVID pandemic is there. It will not go away. Life has changed. The world has changed, and we should recognize that. We should acknowledge that, and we should change our way of living, and our mindset should be changed. I hope I was clear on this, and I hope that it contributed to this very valuable forum today.
Thank you very much, Tania. It seems maybe it was indeed a blessing that your mic was not working initially, so you came through much more in a much more potent manner to close off this particular segment of the forum, and we appreciate your sincere and earnest contribution. I take away from that the need to really appreciate nature and to appreciate what we have. And I think the most important thing you said this morning was that we should move aggressively towards finding practical solutions. We should not just talk, we need tangible results. And this is something that has been echoed by stakeholders across the region, by ministers, by technicians, by entrepreneurs, that we need tangible support. And as I said from the very start, it's not just a talk shop. We have technicians here, we have agencies here who are willing to work together to address the issues. The need to come together is also very important. And I was part of sessions in UECS and Barbados, as well as in Trinidad and Tobago, and practical solutions were identified. And I hope that we can document all of these here. And I remember one colleague out of Trinidad and Tobago, she was stressing the importance of awareness building, simply allowing our consumers and our stakeholders that, as Tamisha would have said out of Jamaica, we are not going to break, that we are going to continue, we are going to persevere, and the need to support our local producers, women, and to some extent the men, I have to represent the men at this point, that we want to build awareness that we are here, that the producers are here to stay, and they are not going to give up. So I think that's something that we should take away. We need to have practical solutions. So I want to thank all the participants from the Caribbean region, as well as our colleague from North America. We appreciate those inputs. And at this point, we would like to have a synthesis of the various presentations. So at this point, I will invite my colleague from Jamaica, Ms. Shauna Hayes, who is the national specialist in the delegation there, as well as Mr. Brent Teofil, who's the national specialist in the St. Lucia office, to provide us with a 10-minute synthesis of the various comments. Let me pass over to my colleagues. The floor is yours.
Hello, Alistair. Hello, everybody on the meeting. This is Shauna from the Jamaica office.
I think Brent is also going to join us. What I am going to suggest, we are both summarizing the discussions. I am going to kind of start with some of the key points that jumped out at me, and I will ask Brent if there's anything that I did not state that he can always add or fill in. Okay, I think, as you rightly said, Alistair, it was possibly, I don't know if the right word is fortuitous, that Tania spoke last, because I think she somewhat set the stage for what is important to take out of this meeting. It is that practical solutions need to happen now. Based on all the various presentations, one thing is clear is that the COVID-19 has been, I'm hearing, is everybody hearing me? I've seen someone say.
I'm hearing you, but sounds like there's somebody speaking in the background, I'm not sure.
Okay, I'm not sure why it sounds like somebody's speaking in the background.
Oh, go ahead, Shauna, you proceed, Shauna.
Okay, fine. All right. So as I said, it is clear that practical solutions need to happen now. One thing is clear from the various presentation is that this COVID-19 was a shock to rural women across the Caribbean. Miss Carmen Nurse in St. Lucia likened it to almost a stillbirth. In terms of you're pregnant and about to deliver and can't deliver, women across the Caribbean would have suffered from a loss of market, loss of income, reduced cash flow, inability to transport to market, even if there was a market. There were challenges relating to increased burden with respect to childcare and with schools being out and having to homeschool, care, cook, multitask, try and, you know, secure your livelihood, try and take care of your family, everything all in one, while at the same time having, loss of all of your normal life, right? There's also communication and information technology challenges. With COVID-19, we are being encouraged to move to a virtual world in a lot of rural communities. IT communication is not reliable, and so we're really beginning to see those weaknesses. People are experiencing, as was mentioned by the representative from Guyana, higher prices for inputs as a result of lower production volumes and higher transportation costs. There's also the noted potential for gender-based violence as a result of just being in a crisis situation, and also the increased stay at home, reporting of people's inability to feed themselves and their families, increased reports of predatory larceny because there's a greater level of desperation as a result of the crisis. These were, I would say, the main challenges that are facing the rural women, and also sometimes an inability to get reliable and accurate information on the COVID-19 situation. It further highlighted challenges that were already existing prior to COVID-19. I think it's Jennifer in Trinidad made that point, is that it re-emphasized the weaknesses already in the system. Ms. Nurse and Tamisha made a point about the fact that prior to COVID-19, we were in a drought situation. So rural women's livelihoods would already have been compromised as a result of the drought. There are issues with respect to land. Young women, you want to plant, but you have less availability to land, unreliable input supply. So all of these challenges were noted. In terms of the recommendations for revolving fund for working capital, capacity building to retool and reposition businesses, greater support to ensure that women are included in decision making. But generally, I think there is a need for women to receive the inputs to, one, be able to feed their families, two, to be able to continue and restart their livelihoods. So Ms. Nurse would have provided, you know, quite an extensive list with respect to facilitating access to markets, economic stimulus packages, you know, water dispensers for market vendors, storage facilities. One of the problems that we're having now is that if you can't sell your produce right away, it's going to perish because we do not have adequate storage facilities to minimize spoilage and waste. You know, assistance with respect to land preparation, seeds, fertilizers, and other inputs, assistance with respect to packaging materials, further promotion of farmers' markets to facilitate access to markets, financial and technical assistance for agro-processors to be able to process possibly some of the surplus produce that is out there. So these were some of the recommendations that were made. And, you know, ensuring that businesses are more resilient. But the emphasis is on being able to provide solutions in the now term, as the point was made by the colleague in Suriname. It is not the time for talking, but the time to be able to offer some practical assistance. And there is also the recommendation for greater collaboration. The representative from Trinidad pointed out that it really does highlight the need that, you know, in crises like these, you need mechanisms where people can support, collaborate, partner, and depend on each other. So that is it in a nutshell. I hope I have represented the concerns adequately.
Thank you, Shauna. Let me ask Brent Theophile if he has any additional input to make. Brent, the floor is yours.
I think Brent has said that his mic is not working for this forum.
Okay.
But I would also, he has sent me some comments on the chat. In addition to the what I would like to call the no assistance, in the long term, particularly since, as was pointed out by the representative from Trinidad, this COVID pandemic has highlighted the vulnerabilities. You know, you can also then look at in terms of the long term, what are the areas that you, the weakest links in the chain, so to speak, that you need to spend time over the medium to long term to correct such vulnerabilities and develop more resilient business models and with diversified income.
Thank you, Shauna. Those points are noted, and I suppose we will document them and get additional comments from Mr. Theophile as well moving forward. Time is against us, and as I said, we would like to respect the input and the time that these colleagues are contributed to this forum. So I want to move quickly to our colleague from the CARICOM Secretariat, and that is Ms. Anne-Marie Williams, who will provide some recommendations for us moving forward. We want to express sincere gratitude for the input of the CARICOM Secretariat. The CARICOM Secretariat continues to partner with IICA to address the issues of agricultural development. We, as an institute, are at the BS, and we're there to support the work of the CARICOM Secretariat, and we work hand in hand together. So we are really grateful for the input of Ms. Williams. Let me quickly indicate that Ms. Williams heads the Regional Gender and Development Program at the CARICOM Secretariat, the Caribbean Community, that is, and she works as the Deputy Program Manager. Her regional mandate is to promote and coordinate the work of gender equality, equity, and women's empowerment among and beyond the region's 20 million inhabitants. By training, she is a British Chevening Scholarship winner, and she has a master's degree in gender and development from the Institute of Development Studies at the University of Sussex in the UK. She has worked in Belize, and by nationality, she's a Belizean, and she has also pursued postgraduate studies in trafficking in persons policy and prevention in 2015 at the American University Washington College of Law in DC, District of Columbia. We recognize that Ms. Williams has a rich history in journalism. She's a former television anchor and news editor of Great Belize Television Channel 5, and during her active media career in radio, television, and print, she has pursued stories around issues of politics, gender equality, economics, and the environment. We therefore welcome Ms. Williams to this forum and look forward to her recommendations to take us forward. Ms. Williams?
Thank you very much, Mr. Green, and thanks to all those listening, well, on Facebook or watching. And to start off, I really want to thank the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation and Agriculture, IICA, for this opportunity. I'm hoping that this would be the start of many more opportunities for our collaboration. But that said, the five women participants we had this morning, they were very much on point with their testimonies, with their experiences, and I really feel that it was an opportunity for enrichment, because during this time, other women can be at home also to listening to hear what they can take away. It's not all doom and gloom with COVID-19, but this is really a rich opportunity to see how we won't break, we will persevere because we're resilient. So I want to start off by framing everything I heard this morning within frameworks that we have in this region. The 2014 Small Island Development State Accelerated Modalities for Action, or the Samoa Pathway, emphasizes the role of women's empowerment as a driver of economic growth. This year, we're celebrating 25 years of the Beijing Declaration and Platform for Action, which is the most comprehensive pathway to achieving gender equality ever put on paper and ever implemented. We're looking at, there's 12 priority pillars in the Beijing platform, and a few of the priority pillars are so pertinent. We look at women and poverty, women and the economy, women in decision-making, women and the environment. Very pertinent to what we're speaking about. Then it's 10 years into the Sustainable Development Goals. We think of 17 goals and 169 targets, and a few goals readily come to mind. Goal 1, which speaks to no poverty. Goal 3, we talk about good health and well-being. Goal 5, gender equality and empowerment of women, which happens to be the driver of all the other goals, because you cannot achieve any of the 17 goals if you don't really achieve gender equality. And yes, there's goal 13, climate action related to this. There's life on land, goal 15. We talk about global partnerships, which is also important, and the reason why this forum is being held also, because how can we partner to support these women? So that is goal 17. And so all these things have, all the issues of COVID-19 that are here with us and that will be here even after COVID disappear, and we hope that it does so quickly. And so how do we go on? How do we forge a new way forward with having our women farmers at the forefront of the conversations and the forefront of development? So taking as part of the recommendations, how do we draw on women's strengths and contributions to pull the Caribbean out of this deep crisis that it has found itself in? Because everything we spoke about today has to be framed within the new COVID reality. And part of that happens to do with the health crisis and its socioeconomic impacts. So how can we remove the impediments also, the impediments that the women spoke about, to women's safety? We talk about gender-based violence, the impediments to participation and equality for them to be able to make those contributions. One of the participants said that when women get their own money, they will become independent and everything. Yes, and part of that independence, we have to nurture that because they will be in a better position to make better contributions. So by knowing more about women's lives, their needs and their interests, I reckon that women will become more independent. Then there's economic resilience. How do we support women as producers of goods and services in the region? There's the issue of social protection, which is a very big recommendation. One of the women spoke of not having enough money and not having enough produce. Well, social protection happens to be one way to support the poorest households, because in low-income countries, only 18% of women, according to the World Bank in 2018, which is the poorest quintile, are covered by social assistance. And this tells us automatically that there's a huge share of the population that's not covered at all by social assistance or by social insurance. So how do we make sure that the systems that are put in place are adequately equipped to not only support women, but to track them first in order to support them? Because a lot of these systems sometimes they're poorly designed and they're subject to political interference, particularly in a region like the Caribbean, which is so small and politically charged in many ways. Land tenure, which is a very big deal for women farmers. During this crisis and after this crisis, we're prone to natural disasters, and this is the soon will start the hurricane season. June 1 will start hurricane season. When there's a disaster and some farmers lose their crops and everything, and the land is cleared, she doesn't own the land, what happens to her livelihood? And so land tenure is not only important for farming, but land tenure is an important device to be used as a collateral for her to get money to even advance her farming. Then we look at an issue like farming farmers cooperatives, which is another big step for women who may not have the collateral, may not have the money in hand to do just that. One of the women spoke about not having access to funding. Well, we really have to get the private sector involved to see how best women can get access to credit and in their own name, not because of their husbands or their partner, but how can they access credit and on good terms too that they can afford to pay. Research shows that when it comes to paying back loans, women do far better than men. And the Grameen Bank is a very good example of that, that was rarely done in India and has become world famous. And so something like that, how do we support something like the Grameen Bank style lending for women? Then the use of technology. Technology is so very important. Technology, women need to learn at that very, very basic level of being just a farmer, as some people would say, to collect research. It doesn't have to be fancy and sophisticated, a survey. So how can you use that technology, a simple phone, to track your data? Access to a bank account, a telephone can give you that. We need to train women also in the issues that are pertinent now and that will stay with us. Issues of gender equality and gender-based violence, along with issues of business development, how to add value and access markets. Things that a lot of people may take for granted that, she's just selling her crops in the field and she's not worried about that. No, we need to get them to worry about that, because we need to make our women farmers independent so that they can have sustainable livelihoods. And I want to say that there's a CARICOM, there's a regional CARICOM gender equality strategy that my program is actually promoting.
2 more minutes, Ms. Williams, 2 more minutes.
Okay, thank you. That has 7 priority areas, and two of the priority areas taken right now speaks to economic empowerment, and the other speaks to climate change. And of course, there's good governance. And we need to make women aware of these frameworks and these avenues that exist, because we don't only want them to plant, we want them to become a part of a society that they will have the opportunity to excel in and pass on their farming skills to a family member, a niece, a nephew, a neighbor, because we need to have women farmers with us for the long, long haul. And so those are some of the recommendations that I would really, really like to see come to fruition in order to help our women farmers in the region, knowing that we're a heavily indebted region, high debts, and monies are involved because we have to pay it back. But in the meantime, we have to set aside the right investment for our women's farmers. It's time and over time, and COVID-19 has brought these fault lines to bear, the kinds of investments that we have not been making. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Williams. And again, special thanks to the CARICOM Secretariat for your input. I believe those recommendations are indeed meaningful, and we would want to take them on board moving forward. Again, let's stress the point raised by Tania. We don't want this to only be a talk shop. We need to come together and we need to obtain tangible solutions, tangible results for the rural women. I therefore challenge everyone here who is listening, whether via Facebook, YouTube, or on this Zoom link, to really get serious. First, to mobilize ourselves and realistically take some of these solutions, some of these recommendations, and develop proposals and get funding, get support for these women. I'm looking forward to the notes coming out of this meeting, and I think that realistically, we can address some of these issues. In closing, let me thank everyone for their participation here today, in particular the panelists who took time to conceptualize and put together these thoughts in this challenging time. I know it's a bit disorienting. Their input was really well received and appreciated. In particular, we want to recognize the contribution of Tania, of Carmen, of Jennifer, Tamisha, Gillian, Sean, and Ms. Williams. We really appreciate and say thank you again. To the IICA Director General, Dr. Otero, and the Director of Technical Cooperation, Dr. Villarreal, your role in putting together this forum is really noteworthy. It's fantastic that we can really address these issues in this challenging time. We hope that we can rely on the support of the IICA Director General and the Director of Technical Cooperation to fashion programs that can benefit these women. To the technicians, thank you again for participating, in particular, Shauna and Brent for making their inputs in terms of the synthesis, and to the other technicians across the region who are listening via the various platforms. We also want to recognize the persons who have provided support to putting together this particular initiative, those persons developing the mics, ensuring that the audio is there and the video connection. And it would be remiss of me to forget the persons who have led this process for the Caribbean, namely Dr. Kurt DeLeese, the Special Affairs Coordinator for the region, and Mrs. Ina Harvey, the representative in Barbados. Ina would have spearheaded this initiative and participated in some of our other sub-forums to get inputs into this process. So Ina and Kurt, we are really grateful for your involvement. With that said, let me wish you all a safe and blessed weekend. The weekend is near. We have this pandemic that's still on our doorstep, and we really need to, as Tania said, come together to address it. Continue to be safe, continue to be mindful that we will not break, as Tamisha said, and we look forward to a further dialogue. And I want to remind you that at the end of this week, we have a hemispheric forum to bring together all the inputs from the various regions. I don't know if my colleague, Dr. Villarreal, has any closing comments, or if we can just simply close off. Thank you.
Thank you, Alistair, and thank you everyone for the time and the rich comments. It's really, really useful for us and to think together the technical cooperations and the future of the rural areas. Thank you very much. Thank you a lot.
Folks, let me invite you all to visit IICA's website for more information, or IICA's Instagram page, Facebook, Twitter, etc. Link up with us, get more information, get involved. Thank you very much.
Thank you too. Have a good afternoon, everyone.
Okay, enjoy the day, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you very
much. Hope to hear you all soon again.